A secret he kept from his family.
I just climbed into a shell for all my teen years.
And the lie he kept telling himself.
This is who people need to accept me to be.
Watch what happens when the truth comes out.
It was like a ton of bricks was lifted off my shoulders.
Plus, the duo behind Fireproof, Facing the Giants, and more. The Kendrick brothers go inside their latest hit, War Room, on today's 700 Club.
Well, welcome to the 700 Club. Is Islam really a religion of peace? President Obama has said it is, as has President Bush, even as violent jihadis carry out terror attacks in the name of Islam.
So, who's right? Well, as George Thomas reports, it's not just about fears of terrorism. Surveys show hundreds of millions of Muslims hold radical views about dominating the world.
With each new terrorist attack, the debate over the true nature of Islam intensifies.
Let's be clear, though. Islam is not our adversary.
This is a civilizational struggle between the values of freedom and liberty and radical Islamic terror.
Those on the left defend Islam, calling it a religion of peace.
Muslims are peaceful and tolerant people and have nothing whatsoever to do with terrorism.
Those on the right want to stop the flow of Muslims to the U.S., concerned about jihadists sneaking in among masses of refugees.
What happened in Paris could happen here. There is no middle ground.
But experts say there's also a much bigger debate.
When there is a disease or a virus, it can't be treated unless you identify the problem. So we have to call it what it is, and it is violent, radical, extremist Islamism.
For over 20 years, Rahil Raza, a Sunni Muslim, has dedicated her life to speaking out against what she calls the rising threat of radical Islam.
This is not an easy topic to discuss.
In her latest project, By the Numbers, The Untold Story of Muslim Opinions and Demographics, Raza warns that Islam presents a great threat.
In light of the fact that most of the terrorism in the world today involves Muslims in one way or another, and because it directly affects our lives and security, I think that we need to be able to have an open, honest, and fact-based conversation about that.
Produced by the Clarion Project, Raza describes so-called spheres of radicalization. At the core is what she calls violent jihadists, like ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Hezbollah, and Boko Haram.
These are the jihadists who murder people in San Bernardino, Texas, Paris, London, Delhi, Jerusalem, Ottawa, Madrid, Nairobi.
A second sphere, Raza says, are those who support jihadist goals but not their methods. For example, while they push for an Islamic takeover, they do so through democratic methods.
Islamists want many of the same things as the jihadists, it's just that their tactics differ.
She points to the large percentage of Egyptians who supported the Muslim Brotherhood, or the Palestinians who voted to give political power to the terrorist group Hamas.
So instead of engaging in terror themselves, they use the political and cultural system to further their aims.
The third sphere, and the largest of them all, is what Raza also calls the most disturbing, the fundamentalists.
The Muslims in this circle are certainly not like ISIS, and they're not working to overthrow governments like the Muslim Brotherhood. But they do hold beliefs and practices that no doubt will seem radical to you and me.
She points to an exhaustive Pew Research project in 2013 that interviewed thousands of Muslims across 39 countries. In the survey, large numbers of Muslims, representing millions of people, thought it was justifiable to execute people who converted away from Islam and to murder women who dishonor the family.
These studies paint a picture of an Islamic world that is increasingly out of step with the modern world.
In the same survey, alarming numbers of young Muslims in Western countries also supported suicide bombings.
42% of French Muslims, 35% of British Muslims, and 26% of American Muslims believe suicide bombings against non-Muslims can be justified.
And equally shocking, Raza adds, is the large percentage of Muslims who want Sharia law, which calls for stoning of adulterers and chopping off thieves' hands, to be the law of the land.
Of course, not every Muslim believes in these things, but hundreds of millions do. The numbers are right here for all to see.
Raza says if radical Islam is ever to be defeated, an honest conversation must happen about one of the most important issues of our time.
By silencing the debate about radical Islamist beliefs, we abandon our own core beliefs of truth, free speech, and tolerance. And we abandon human rights in favor of political correctness.
Raza says the documentary is meant to start that conversation. George Thomas, CBN News.
We need to be involved in the conversation, involved with questions like, how can Hamas win an election in the Gaza Strip? How can a terrorist group win a popular election? How can the Muslim Brotherhood win an election in Egypt unless there wasn't a strong opinion in that electorate that they would run the country well? We need to look at these numbers. We need to look at what is causing radical jihadists to arise from Islam. What is it about public opinion? What is it about what is being preached in the mosque? How can we get translations of those sermons to better understand why are people being radicalized? The chilling numbers from this, 26% of American Muslims think suicide bombing is okay in some instances. That's a startling fact. If you want more information about this, we've got it for you. It's on cbnnews.com. You can see the full video from the Clarion Project. You can find out more about the Pew Center research that went into that video and how you can be a part of the conversation. So go to cbnnews.com. Terry?
Well, coming up, a major arrest in the San Bernardino shootings and a heated argument in Congress over America's visa program. We've got the rest of today's top headlines right after this.
Welcome back to the 700 Club, a new terrorism charge in the San Bernardino massacre. Federal officials say a childhood friend of shooter Syed Farouk had plotted terrorism before and should have done more to stop the attack. The news comes as lawmakers are demanding answers about failures in the U.S. visa program that allowed one of the shooters into the country. Caitlin Burke has the story.
Plot after plot developed between friend Syed Farouk and Enrique Marquez. One, an attack on a Southern California community college. Another, against drivers stuck in rush hour traffic. They date back to 2011, but they were never followed through on. Then Farouk and his ISIS-supporting bride launched their own strike in San Bernardino using Marquez's weapons.
He has provided them with a lot of detail about the weapons, about possibly other attacks planned.
Now, 2 weeks after the San Bernardino attacks, Marquez is behind bars, facing serious terror charges.
Marquez himself called 911 after the attack, identifying Farouk as the killer and admitting the guns had been his own. This kind of attack has Americans afraid. A new Washington Post ABC News poll shows only 2 out of 10 people think lone wolf attacks can be stopped. But President Obama is trying to reassure Americans there's no evidence of an imminent attack in the U.S. over the holidays.
We cannot give in to fear or change how we live our lives, because that's what terrorists want.
Speaking at the Counterterrorism Center in McLean, Virginia, the president said that changes are being made to strengthen the security of the visa waiver program. Some lawmakers on the House Oversight Committee questioned immigration officials Thursday about their inability to keep track of visa violators.
We can either tell the American people that our process and our systems are flawed and that we have missed information that is otherwise available and let them deal with that, or we can just tell our fellow citizens we missed nothing. We did everything we were supposed to do, and there's still 14 funerals in California, so you just need to get used to the risk. Neither one of those is acceptable, I would argue to you.
If we're bringing 10,000 refugees and we miss just 1%, that's 100 terrorists. It didn't take that many in Paris, and it certainly didn't take that many in San Bernardino.
Meanwhile, lawmakers want answers about why the Department of Homeland Security granted a visa to one of the San Bernardino attackers, even though she had revealed her desire for jihad on social media. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
A Brooklyn civil court judge is under fire for taking her oath of office by swearing in on a Quran. Carolyn Walker Diallo used the Muslim book as the testament of her Islamic faith. The New York Daily News reports that led to a social media backlash as people posted comments critical of her and Islam. Walker Diallo is not the first Muslim official sworn in with the Quran in the U.S. Democratic Congressman Keith Ellison of Minnesota did so as well in 2008. Schools in one Virginia county are closed today after a backlash over an assignment about Islam. Augusta County officials closed all schools Friday after the school district was flooded with angry messages. Parents were outraged because students in a world geography class were required to write the Islamic statement of faith in Arabic. The statement says there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Students did not receive a translation of what they were writing. The school's website says the lesson was not designed to promote a religious viewpoint or change any student's religious belief. Parents at a Kentucky school fought back last night after the school dropped Jesus from their Charlie Brown Christmas play. Johnson County school officials censored the part of the play when Linus quotes the Bible, telling Charlie Brown about the true meaning of Christmas. But the Lexington Herald Leader reports that parents in the audience responded last night by loudly reciting the deleted Bible verse during the play performance. The school had removed the verse after receiving one single complaint. Christmas is a busy time of year, especially for scammers. The hustle and bustle can give them even more opportunities to take advantage of people. That's why the Better Business Bureau introduced a scam tracker to expose popular scams and keep you from becoming the next victim. Be careful about lookalike websites when doing your Christmas shopping. They may steal your money or send fake products. Also, watch out for fake shipping emails. They can have links that download malware to your computer. There's also a gift card scam that prompts you to use a gift card to get a special deal. And the Better Business Bureau reports phone scams are big too, including fake tech support, fake sweepstakes offering a prize for a small fee, and the IRS scam when the caller tells you you're in trouble with the IRS unless you pay now.
That I'll be going to jail and agents would be coming to handcuff me and take me away. Felt very bad, very bad.
We have a link for the scam tracker showing the latest scam alert at cbnnews.com. The Pacific Northwest is often called the Nun Zone because most people living there claim no religious affiliation. But one church may have found the secret to reaching the unreachable. Abigail Robertson shows us that their success started when they went back to the Bible.
7 years ago, the future looked pretty bleak for Westminster Community Church, a 92-year-old congregation located in Seattle.
We started to decline at a pretty crazy rate. In fact, I published that our going out of business date was going to be November of 2011 if we didn't do something different.
The more the city grew, the more its people changed.
90% of Seattle are very secularized in their worldview.
Members of Westminster realized they had to roll with these changes in order to reach these people.
So if we're hoping to stay in business here, we need to know how to take seculars to heaven in a way that they would gladly go.
After a number of failed attempts, church leaders decided on a tactic from biblical times.
The church for the first 300 years, it really was a dinner church. And once we started to own that, we thought, well, we've tried everything else and failed miserably. Let's go try this.
Lead pastor Verlin Fosner says it only took about 6 weeks for their community dinners to make a difference.
They were just flooding at us. So they just start grabbing a hold of their friends and say, hey, this is the family dinner table for this neighborhood. And we've all wanted to be neighbors. Well, now we've got a spot to have a family dinner and this church provides it. And they talk about Jesus. And it's actually kind of interesting. And it's not real religious, but it's very inspiring to us.
Each night of the week, Community Dinners opens their doors somewhere in Seattle and invites people to share a meal together while hearing the good news of God's love.
The one thing that I hear consistently is the peace in the room. People come in and they just go, there's a peace here, I feel peaceful.
Brendan Perko literally helped spread this gospel community by starting the Pike Market location 3 years ago. He sees the dinner table as a very effective tool for discipleship.
A lady that's been with us maybe for about 2 months, 2.5 months, she always says, well, I'm not Christian, I'm actually Buddhist, and I don't know about all this, but I do know when I come here, I feel uplifted, I feel encouraged, and I feel loved.
Brendan made one of his first connections with Tulela, a man he invited in off the street.
Some days I'll come in here and I don't even feel like being here, and Brandon would guide me through it, pray with me. That's why I keep coming here, because I know it helps. It helps out. So the Lord, God guides me back to these people. Because if I'm not doing this, I'm out there doing other stuff that's not good. These people changed my life.
In a city not known for faith, community dinner churches could help change that perception. 20 new locations are planned, one for each walking village around Seattle.
We're glad you're here.
Okay.
And the idea is picking up steam. Community dinners has garnered national attention from pastors around the country, and it has even proven to be a financially sustainable church model.
$1,600 a month, and you can open up a dinner church that'll take care of 150 people a week. And so so money is really not much of an issue when it's that inexpensive.
And now they offer affordable housing and job assistance as part of their service.
Eat together, include the poor, include the stranger, and remember me, talk about me. And what better discipleship is there than when you're sitting at a table talking about Christ every week?
Verlin and his team have definitely answered Jesus's call to feed my sheep, proving that it only takes a little to reach a great amount of people. Reporting from Seattle, Abigail Robertson, CBN News.
Preach the gospel, use words if necessary. Gordon.
Well, it's a throwback, if you will. If you read the New Testament, you find these references to things called love feasts. And that's what the early church would do. They would get together and break bread. Communion would be part of it, but it was also a family meal, a community meal. And everyone was equal. That was the goal of the love feast. Everyone was equal. Everyone was equal before the Lord. And that's how the early church grew. So hats off to that wonderful church, that wonderful pastor. And let's get out and be the church. Tara?
Well, up next, a gay man shares his thoughts on being, quote, born that way.
People would tell me I was born that way, and I would parrot that same phrase. Something deep, deep within me knew that that was not really who I was.
So who was he really, and why does he say that gay people can change? We'll find out when we come back. For more than a decade, Stephen Bennett lived a gay lifestyle. He had numerous affairs with men, and he went to drag shows impersonating women. A counselor told Stephen he had to accept who he was, and he did, until an old friend came knocking on his door.
I loved my father. I craved my father's love. I became an overachiever just to get my father's, his acceptance or his approval.
Stephen Bennett never could win his father's affection. Unlike his dad, who was an alcoholic, Stephen preferred art over sports and the company of girls. That brought on a barrage of insults from his father and his peers that Stephen feared were true.
Always struggling, feeling that I was different, struggling with my identity. Am I gay? Am I queer?
Then at 11 years old, Stephen was molested by a man who was a friend of the family.
I just climbed into a shell for all my teen years. I never told my mother or father what happened, never told anybody. And I just kind of sank deep into my artwork, into music, being a loner, and that really affected me and my own thoughts of who I was as a male.
Throughout his school years, he fought a desire to be with men. Then in his freshman year at Pratt Institute of Art and Design, he had his first homosexual encounter after a night of partying. Now 18 years old, he decided it was time to stop hiding.
And so when I did finally come out that next day, it was very freeing. It was freeing in a sense that I could finally say, okay, I'm a gay man, this is who I am, and this is who people need to accept me to be. And that then for me began an 11-year descent into the homosexual lifestyle, which really screwed me up big time.
After dropping out of college, Stephen became a thriving portrait artist. The year was 1981, and the AIDS epidemic was headline news. The disease had claimed the lives of many of Stephen's friends and partners, driving him to use drugs and alcohol. And as much as he claimed to embrace the lifestyle, he knew he was living a lie.
Am I gay? Am I really gay? And while I believed it, I guess if you will, on the surface, and people would tell me I was born that way and I would parrot that same phrase, something deep, deep within me knew that that was not really who I was.
Through rehab, Stephen overcame his addiction to drugs and alcohol. But for years, he was still deeply involved in the homosexual lifestyle. One day, his childhood friend, Kathy, showed up at his door.
Can I come and talk to you about Jesus and about your homosexuality? I mean, what do those two things have to do with each other?
Stephen met with her and listened quietly as she read verses from the Bible pertaining to homosexuality.
Then she finally gets to a verse that I've never seen before in the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. The extortioner, the adulterer, the murderer, the homosexual, all of these people will not inherit the kingdom of God. But verse 11 was the one that was life-changing for me. It said, and such were some of you, but you've been washed, you've been sanctified, set apart for God's holy use, you've been justified, made right before God. And I never saw that before, and I said to her, wait a second, are you telling me that gay people can change?
Kathy assured Stephen that God loved him, and with his help, he could. But Stephen wasn't interested in changing. He was in a relationship he believed would give him all the love and acceptance he needed. That is, until his partner suggested they be with other men.
And when he said this to me, it just jabbed me in the heart with a knife. I mean, that's basically what you did. I'm not good enough for you. You need somebody else. And when he said that to me, in my mind, I said, you know what? It's all the same. It's never gonna change.
Rejected, Stephen turned to the Bible and even went to church looking for answers.
For the next year and a half, little by little, that word of God started to change me literally from the inside out, until it got to a point one night where tears were coming out of my eyes. God removed the blinders from my eyes, and now here I was crying out for forgiveness to a God I didn't even know.
He called Kathy and explained what happened.
And the best way that I knew how, I prayed with her that day in my partner's home, on the phone, crying, and I asked Christ into my heart. And literally at that moment, I felt a peace come over me. I could never explain the way that I felt. It was like a ton of bricks was lifted off my shoulders.
Stephen left his partner and began his new life in Jesus Christ. In time, he learned that his father also had a difficult childhood and forgave him. He remembers the day he told him.
And that day, my father gave me a hug. He gave me a kiss on the cheek. And for the first time I can ever remember, my father said, Stevie, I love you. And he said, I'm sorry also. And that moment is when I can honestly say my homosexuality broke. You see, all of those years I was looking for the love of my father in the arms of other men. Not sexually, of course, but I wanted my father's love, and now I had the real thing.
Then in 1993, he married Irene, and they later had two children, who are now teenagers. They also started a ministry that reaches out to the gay and lesbian community with a message of love and hope that comes through Jesus Christ.
I've had numerous partners who I've buried in the ground and friends who've died from HIV/AIDS. It's a miracle I was never infected. But I'll tell you, what God has done in my life, I thank God every day for my wife and for my children. He has taken my story, which was a nightmare, and my reality today is sometimes I feel like I'm living a fairy tale. I never, ever want to go back to that old person who I was, and I have no reason to. I have the truth today. I have the real thing.
I think there's a longing inside every one of us for a father, for our father. You know, psychologists say that it's a mother who nurtures her children, but it's the father who calls forth the man and the woman in them. And so as we grow up, we want our identity to be known. We want to understand who we are. And if there has been a lack of definition in our lives, a lack of love, if there's been abuse, we get mixed up. Wonderful book that a friend of mine wrote called the broken image. You know, the Bible says we're made in the image and likeness of God, who is our Father. Also says He knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. God doesn't make mistakes, but life sometimes happens in ways that distort the image that we were made in the likeness of. If you've struggled with this in your own life, the good news is you can change. The good news is we all can change. God wants us to know Him inside and out. He already knows us that way. So if you're looking for the love of a father, if you're looking for who you are, if your identity has been smudged by life, by circumstances, come to the only one who can really define who you are for you. God loves you so much. And yet there are boundaries for Him. He has said, this is the way I've created you. This is the way you're to live. And when we walk outside of those boundaries, we not only are snubbing our noses at Him, we open our hearts and our lives up to all kinds of things that are wounding and that define us inaccurately, inappropriately. You can change. You can be changed. It's not something you grit your teeth and do. It's something that you come to a Father who loves you so deeply, and you say, God, show me who you are. Show me who I am. Teach me your ways. You know, there is a point in every life where we have to do this, where we have to come to the end of ourselves and say, God, it's you. We were created by a Father who loved us, to walk in a garden in the cool of the evening with Him, in perfect fellowship. Achieving that on earth can be quite a challenge, but God wants us to know Him, and He wants to mend the brokenness in us. And His promise is that we will have that garden. We will have that moment-to-moment, day-to-day walk and time and fellowship with Him. But we need to surrender to who He is and to what His plan is. So today, if there's something you're struggling with in your life, there's someone standing by who'd love to pray with you about that. It's somebody just like you and me who's gone through this process and has come to that place of saying, God, I want less of me and more of you. I want to know who I am by your definition, not the world's, and not even my broken image. Call the number on your screen. It's toll-free. It's 1-800-759-0700. You don't even have to give your name. Just talk to the person on the other end of the line. Say, would you pray with me today? And let them read for you the Word of God. There's power in God's Word. There's truth in God's Word. And there's the capacity to hear truth and be changed in God's Word. So call today. Gordon?
Well, coming up later, the brothers behind the number one Christian movie of the year. Alex and Stephen Kendrick take us to the War Room later on today's show.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. A Canadian pastor has been sentenced to a life of hard labor in a North Korean prison camp for alleged crimes against the state. North Korea's highest court handed down the sentence against Hyun-Soon Lim after a 90-minute trial. Lim is in his early 60s and pastors like Korean Presbyterian Church in Toronto. Family and friends say he's made more than 100 visits to North Korea, where he supports a nursing home, a nursery, and an orphanage. He was detained last February and charged with trying to use religion to destroy the state. Prosecutors had asked for the death penalty. Operation Blessing is providing relief to refugees in Greece. Hundreds of refugees from the Middle East continue arriving on the shores of Lesbos every day. Operation Blessing is on the ground providing much-needed kitchen equipment and food supplies, including a new industrial stove and cooking tools, so teams of international volunteers can feed hungry families as they arrive. Operation Blessing is right now serving about 300 hot meals every day with ingredients purchased locally. You can find out more about Operation Blessing by going to its website, ob.org. Gordon and Terry are back with more of the 700 Club. It is coming up right after this.
Over the last few years, millions of Jews from around the world have returned to the land of the Bible. But for many, it's not an easy journey. So CBN is there to help.
Masha Poplovsky moved from Ukraine to Israel, hoping to make a better life for her son, Daniel.
It's very hard to raise a child in Ukraine. There aren't many jobs, and the war has made things difficult. Being a Jew, I had always heard about Israel, and it was my dream to come here.
Masha and her son stayed with Ukrainian friends when they first arrived. But the apartment was very small, and the friends soon asked her and Daniel to leave.
I was very depressed. I wanted to make it on my own, but I didn't know the language or how to find a job or an apartment yet. I was scared we would have to go back to Ukraine.
When CBN Israel learned about Masha, we invited her to come live in the House of Life, a place where single moms who need some extra help can stay free of charge.
I was very nervous at first, but the CBN people spoke Russian and made me feel very comfortable. I made friends with the other girls very quickly.
We taught Masha how to budget her finances and build a resume. She learned the basics of living in Israel and saved money while staying in the house. We also provided Masha and Daniel with good meals every day.
The people there really became my family, and I learned so much in the house. It was a great experience.
Masha and her son recently moved into their own apartment. Today, Masha supports Daniel on her own, but we still visit just to make sure they're okay.
There is no way we would have made it without your help. This situation in Ukraine is terrible for my baby, so going back would have been horrible. We were only able to stay in Israel because CBN helped us in every way possible. Thank you for that.
And thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of that blessing. If you're not a member, join with us. A portion of every gift goes into the work of Operation Blessing. Another portion goes into the work of CBN International to help people, to preach the gospel around the world, to be his hands, his feet, extended to people in need. And if you want to be a part of that, all you have to do is join. How much is it? It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. So do it now. 1-800-759-0700. And when you join, I want you to have this. That's the latest DVD from my father, The Transforming Word. It's verses to overcome fear and experience peace. It's a two-part. There's a DVD and there's a CD. And on the CD are Bible verses, so you can listen to it in your car. You can download it into an iPad. So the Bible is being read to you. Verses to overcome fear and experience peace. It's yours when you join. And if you want to designate a gift to CBN Israel, there's a place you can do it. All you have to do is go to cbn.com. And on the giving page, you can click on, I want to give to CBN Israel. And your contribution will go to help all the things we're doing in Israel, whether that's the relief effort you just saw, or our CBN news team in Jerusalem, the wonderful documentaries we're doing. It's all made possible because people like you care enough to give. So go to CBN.com to do it, or you can just call us and say, I want to give to CBN Israel. Terry?
Well, up next, the dynamic duo of Christian films. The Kendrick brothers share how a dream helped make War Room when we come back.
Hollywood execs return from their Labor Day weekends to find a bit of a surprise in their inbox. The Christian film War Room was the number one movie in America. It's just the latest in a string of hits from the Kendrick brothers, who are joining us now via satellite from New York to talk more about it. Stephen and Alex, thank you for sitting down with us.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you. I hear that War Room was birthed out of a dream. Tell us about that.
Well, we have been making movies since we were very young. We made silly movies running around with a home video camera. Instead of James Bond, it was Savings Bond, or instead of Indiana Jones, it was Alabama Jones. And the Lord got a hold of our hearts. We came from a praying home, and we began making feature films about 10 years ago that had stories that would draw people to a closer walk with God. Flywheel, Facing the Giants, Fireproof, Courageous, and now War Room, which talks about fighting your battles in prayer first, as Matthew 6, verse 6 tells us to do. So very excited about the response to War Room. It apparently has hit a nerve, and people identify with it, and now it comes out on DVD on December 22nd.
You two have been in ministry for 20 years, so you've been doing movies for 10, so all of this is birthed out of a goal for ministry. What's your goal with War Room? It looks like it's a primer on we need to pray more. We need to pray more as Christians. We need to pray more as churches. Is that your goal?
Absolutely. You know, we grew up in a praying home, saw incredible answers to prayer in our parents' lives. We attend a praying church that has an active, vibrant prayer ministry. And Jesus prioritized prayer. He said, "My house shall be called a house of prayer." Throughout the book of Acts, you see that the church devoted themselves to prayer, and we're challenged to do the same. And so we know that our nation desperately needs an intervention from God. He calls us to repentance and to prayer. So we tried to put in this movie truths that will transform people's lives, and we know it can have a positive impact on America if the church will humble ourselves and begin to seek His face. So we tried to interweave that message in an entertaining storyline that can hopefully touch their hearts at the same time.
Yeah. You've got a whole companion to it, the battleground for prayer, to go along with the movie. Does that release at the same time? How can people get that?
Yeah, our book, The Battle Plan for Prayer, was written to come out with the movie, and this is what it's for. That book walks them through specifically how to pray. You know, prayer is not your spare tire. It should be more your steering wheel. And so we walk, how do you biblically pray over your spouse, your children, our culture, and other issues that you may be fighting. So people will resonate with it, not only the book Battle Plan for Prayer, but the movie War Room. And it's our hope that God will stir hearts once again, and we want to see revival and a renewed sense of faith in our culture. And we hope that this movie and book are a little part of it.
Your movie, I don't know if you were intentional with this, but it seems the timing, particularly with an African-American cast, the timing is absolutely needed in America today. We have a huge racial divide that doesn't seem to want to ever heal. Was that intentional on your part, or did you just walk into it?
Well, we believe the Lord led us into that. That was not our expectation. But it's interesting to see while the nation is becoming more racially divided, the church is becoming more racially united. Yeah. And we see that prayer is one of those common bonds that when we're praying for each other, God gives us a love for each other. We saw it happen on set as we worked on War Room, and we've seen it happen in communities. Black churches and white churches walking out of the theater after having seen this film, embracing praying together in theater atriums, and beginning pastors meeting together praying for their city. So we hope that churches will keep using War Room to call their churches back to prayer. And the special features that are on the DVD, we walk through how churches can launch prayer ministries. We give examples of answered prayer in our own lives and exactly what happened on set. So we hope people will check it out. It's a great stocking stuffer. So December 22nd, when the War Room hits the stores, we hope that people will be able to watch it with their whole family and be inspired in their spiritual lives at the same time.
You've got some pushback from the studio about the movie and about the cast. How did you respond?
Well, you know, we're in it for ministry before business. They're in it for business. But when the movie does well, we both end up happy. And we're just grateful to have a pipeline that goes to 76 countries around the world. And the movie's coming out in over 40 languages on DVD, depending on what region you're in. And so we're very grateful for that. And so Hollywood usually looks with a skeptic's eye toward issues of faith, at least initially. But no one can argue with the results that we've seen with War Room. You know, people being inspired to pray, and again, there were managers of theaters that told us later they had to go in the theater after War Room had finished showing and tell people that were praying in the theater, "We need you to move out so the next group of people can come in and see this film." Mm-hmm. And so what a great problem to have, and we hope that the Lord again just calls people back to devoted prayer, making Him a priority.
That is a wonderful story, and that's a wonderful result. Do you think Hollywood's getting the message that movies about faith that are accurate, and we've seen a couple of disasters in this area, but are they getting the message that these actually work financially? Not only are they a blessing spiritually, but for distributors, for movie chains, it's actually profitable. Are they getting the message?
We hope so. It seems like after The Passion of the Christ came out, and then our movie Courageous and Fireproof, when they came out, they're surprised every time they are successful, and they're reminded that there is a massive audience out there who usually doesn't go see Hollywood movies. But if you'll honor the scriptures and you will honor their families and their faith at the same time, then they will show up in support. So we hope that not only will they continue to support these kind of films, but that they will make them in a way that will honor the scriptures.
Right.
Because the disasters that you've seen are usually when they don't honor the scriptures at the same time.
Well, what's next for you? Being successful in films is like the reward of the pie eating contest. You get to have more pie, so you get to have another movie. What's next on the horizon?
Well, we want to take a little bit of a break to invest more time with our wives and kids. We're doing that now, and we're praying about what's next. We have several ideas that we're interested in pursuing, but we're going to do that after the break, and we're seeking the Lord for that. So we have no shortage of ideas. We just want to make sure that the very next thing we do is exactly what the Lord prompts us to do.
All right. Well, it comes out on the 22nd, so that means you get a little bit of a break and have fun with your family and have a very Merry Christmas. Well, War Room releases on DVD and Blu-ray on Tuesday. It's just in time for Christmas. So if you're looking for a perfect stocking stuffer, be sure to grab a copy. It's War Room, and it's available nationwide. Terry?
Well, coming up, we'll be answering your email questions. Plus, see how an Alabama church spreads holiday cheer all year round.
If you listen, you'll hear a need wherever you go, and you just try to feel that.
See how they fill those needs with the help of an old beat-up truck. That's next.
They're beautiful tonight. I think it's one of the most glorious Christmas leaves, and I'm just the very proposal to come by.
When Pastor Thomas Martin saw an old Salvation Army food truck for sale, he saw more than just a beat-up old truck. Pastor Thomas saw a new way to serve hope to the local community. Take a look.
Like any good pastor, Thomas Martin has a heart for his community.
One way or another, we'll come get you this coming up Sunday morning.
Okay.
And it's something he shares with his church.
We're from Hope House Church, and we just wanted to bless your community with dinner tonight.
From yard work to minor maintenance, he and his church are always looking for ways to serve.
God didn't just call us to come to church, but he called us to be the church and to love the community that God's placed us into. And a big part of what that is, that God's given to, onto our plate, is the food truck ministry that we find ourselves in now.
You heard him right, a food truck. It started when a friend told Pastor Martin about an old rusty food truck he was selling.
Truthfully, it was pretty rough.
But a new way to feed the community was born.
I felt like God was saying, why don't you do something? And all of a sudden David said, well, Thomas, why don't you do something? I could feel the sense that Holy Spirit was still leading me and guiding me and say, this is right.
His little church caught the vision too and raised $15,000 in 1 week, enough to buy and fix the truck.
We began to equip the truck and put in appliances and clean it up. The truck is awesome. It has a 6-burner stove and a big commercial oven, a flat top. We show up and they come running to receive a good dinner. We average probably between 100 and 300 people at a time. But you can only fix so much food at one time.
So Pastor Martin plans on renovating part of their new church, a recently purchased 60-year-old warehouse, for food truck prep.
We need a big commercial kitchen and prep area that we can fix bulk food, put it in the warmer pans, put it in the warmer drawers on our food truck, and then go out in the community and then serve hot food plated one plate at a time for the people. We have a heart to open up a true soup kitchen, to be open up different days of the week to serve food straight out of the church as an extension of what we do. Our heart is to be able to feed and love this community.
It's a pleasure to us to have y'all come today.
Right.
It's just wonderful, and we love it. Thank you.
And the food truck had an unexpected effect.
As we begin to serve and begin to do this ministry, other churches in our area have stepped up and said, hey, you know, we can help you with this. I love the concept of going out, reaching out in the community, other churches, and just teaming up with them to do ministry.
If you listen, you'll hear a need wherever you go, and you just try to fill that.
Help your fellow man. I do believe that's one of the main first reasons for being here on the earth.
There are a lot of people, not only in Jasper, Alabama, but all over the place that are living in a life that truly is hope deferred. They really can't see that tomorrow will be a better day. But I can tell you for sure that when that truck pulls up into an area where some people are really needy, and we flip down that counter, and the smells of hot food begin to go out those windows, I believe that somehow we're making them understand that there is hope for me. Someone loved me. Someone saw me. Someone was willing to drive up here and pull up this truck in my driveway and show the love of Christ to me.
Serving up Christ's love to Jasper with a side of hope.
Well, Pastor Martin is doing great work, and now he's hoping he can remodel the truck's kitchen. If you'd like to find out more about the loaves and fish food truck by going to our website, you can help that, cbn.com. Take a look, because they need your help, and they are making a difference. So great way to partner with them.
I love what you said. If you listen, you can hear a need. Mm-hmm. That's a great way to look at it.
That's a great line. Well, here's Bring It On, Gordon. The first one comes from Shannon, who says, I grew up with a father who did not care about me. He was not involved in my life. Since I became a Christian and studied the Ten Commandments and other aspects of the Bible, I've read that God wants me to honor my father. How do I honor a father who's not a part of my life? I've reached out to him several times, but he rejects my love and relationship. I want to do God's will and obey his commandments, but I'm just not sure how to do this.
Shannon, in terms of your earthly father, my recommendation, if you want to honor him, he's telling you quite clearly he doesn't want to have a relationship. So honor that. And in that honoring, you're going to fulfill the requirement of the commandment. You don't have to force yourself on him. There's a real truth to you. You can't make somebody love you. You can't do that. What I'm hearing also in your question is you have a real heart need. This is more than how can I honor my parents and obey the commandments. You have a real heart need. And sometimes as Christians, we need to be reparented. So I would encourage you, how can you get what you need from your Heavenly Father? And He promises, when your father abandons you, he will raise you up. And so in your prayer life, I would encourage you to do that. Say, God, can you be my father today? Can you tell me all the things I wanted my earthly father to share with me? Can we have those moments together? And can you be my daddy? Not some distant God, but can you be my daddy? He'll honor that prayer, and he'll come to you, and he'll show you how much he loves you.
Okay, this is a viewer, Gordon, who says, our daughter and her husband are not Christians. 2 months ago, they were in horrible financial distress, and they were flat broke. I told them that they needed to pray and ask God to provide. They did pray, and God did answer. I thought this would have brought them a step closer to the Lord. Instead, they got what they needed, and now they're back to their sinful ways. I pray for them daily to become Christians. As a mom, how do I handle them using God just when they need Him and only for their benefit?
I wouldn't try to handle it. It's not something to handle. Realize it's the goodness of God that leads to repentance. And so count it all joy that there's now been the goodness of God evident in their life. He has answered their prayer. He saved them from their distress. He showed Himself strong for them. Now, what do you do? Well, you pray and you ask God for more messengers after His own heart to come to them, and let the goodness of God transform them. You can look at it judgmentally, but don't. Ask God to love them even more and see what happens. We leave you these words from Romans 5. The love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, who was given to us. God bless you and Merry Christmas.